I think games offer a unique opportunity as a medium to create experiences that really invite the player to bring their own experience and therefore their own interpretation to the game.
It's about expanding the spectrum of what video game can provide as a medium. We thought if we would be able to help to grow this medium, we need to present to the world that games can be about these feelings. They can provide these emotions.
I had read The Fountainhead by Ayn Rand, and I enjoyed it. It certainly made an interesting impression on me. The goal was, at the beginning, it's like, let's take these notions of, these philosophical notions, and put them in a world where things can go off track, potentially.
An odd world was always supposed to be this sort of dark side of globalization reflecting the real world.
I think gaming is unlike any other medium in the sense that you can engage an individual's undivided attention for hours at a time and embody the main character, making choices, taking action. I mean, this is what makes gaming such a powerful medium. It's a tool through which you can see the world through another person's eyes.
I am your regular host, Albert, and today I am joined by the host, the main creator, founder of the Dark Crystal podcast, Trial by Stone, Mr. Philip Mitchell. Welcome, Philip.
Hello, Albert. I just want to say, thanks for inviting me to this new show of yours.
Cheers, man. It's a pleasure, privilege, and an honor to have you on the show, as I mentioned in the pre-show. So glad to have you, man. Fantastic, Philip. So I'm going to obviously have a bit of fun editing this, but
yeah, it's all right.
As soon as I said, let's get the show started, gigantic swell of the Trevor Jones theme. Da, na, na, na. You better believe it, son.
Yeah, I know. With my interviews, I always go to the Podling village.
Yeah.
So let's go to the Podling village and chat to.
I love it. It's so good. Dude, you create an atmosphere with your show. Don't you find, like, with books, like the best of, like, audiobooks even, or like movies as well, you yourself, like, that's why I said earlier, and I wasn't like exaggerating or like going into, I gain nothing from superlatives or smoke blowing or hyperbole. Yeah. It's just like, yeah, the feeling of your podcast actually does feel like, oh, I'm in the Podling village. I'm actually there chilling out in the Thra with Jin, you know, with Kira. It's so good, dude.
Thanks. Yeah. No, it's just something, you know, I try to have fun with it every now and then. And I mean, especially like, you know, if I have, you know, interviews to people who are, you know, part of the franchise as well, that, you know, I do probably put a little bit more effort with some of those interviews, just to, you know, get the story across of just imagining the story and putting it to the music sort of can work sometimes. Yeah.
Well, with mine, you don't have to, like, please. You can even just have silence. Just like, oh, this is just Albert, man. Like, we don't need clips for that guy. I'm kidding.
Yeah.
But that's actually, listeners, I may as well announce it here. Speaking of being on each other's shows, I will be on very graciously, I definitely don't take it for granted, and I came as a really pleasant sort of happening Philip is I'm gonna be on his show to discuss, is it the creation myths, or which one are we
So there's three shows that are happening that are sort of part of the Dark Crystal podcast network of sorts. So we have Trial by Stone, which is the interview sort of style show, or interview people who are either fans or have worked on the films or actively working on new Dark Crystal projects. And then the one that that you'll be a part of is called The Gathering Songs, which is sort of a roundtable discussion show of all things Dark Crystal. And I have done some, like, in the past under the Trial by Stone shows. So I have done episodes with roundtable discussions about the graphic novels, the creation myths, as well as the Shadows of the Dark Crystal. And I think even, like, there was a PDF document that was on the official Dark Crystal website called the Gelfling Gathering. And that sort of gave a backdrop of all the different Gelfling clans and all these different characters. So, which is pretty cool. So, I'm very, very excited to get into with the new format with the Gathering Songs, and our first sort of new episodes will be about Shadows of the Dark Crystal. But right now Right now, what's happening with that show is we're re-releasing the old episodes of Trial by Stone to put them just under a new banner, and then down the track, we'll have that new content with, you know, discussion on Song of the Dark Crystal and much more.
And then your third segment is the Dark Crystal Minute.
Yes, it is. Yeah. So, and that's with myself and a good friend of mine from the US, Jamie, and it's inspired by a lot of, I guess, like movies by minute podcasts. And I think it was really, I think the first one that started it all was about the Big Lebowski, but it was sort of Star Wars. I think it was like I can't remember the name of that podcast.
It was the Star Wars Minute, I think.
Yeah, that sort of popularized it. And a lot of people decide to make their own podcasts, you know, where on each episode, they'll talk about what happens within a minute of the Dark of the films. So, for example, with the Dark Crystal, it goes for 95 minutes. So there'll be at least 95 episodes, which will probably be about 100 episodes, you know, if we had special episodes in between in the mix, if it does happen. Just chatting about the Dark Crystal, and just really going into the specifics of, you know, what happens, and you know, there'll be things that we've never seen before, never thought about. So it makes great discussion.
Yeah, I found that too, definitely, and so much of the reason that, like, there's a listeners for you wondering about the collaboration kind of here between Phil and I is that when I detect, this is actually related to our new upcoming show, The Shadow Dome, as well. When there's the sort of that shared DNA of a certain, they call it a genre, or call it a medium, which is or call it a property like Dark Crystal, or in our case games, there is this shared notion that there's something that, like, the wider world still hasn't really caught on to, that there isn't, like, there are layers and dimensions to this material that is so rewarding and so enriching to dive into and appreciate on so many more levels than on the surface level. And so our new show, The Shadow Dome, like, that refers to a word in the universe. It's like where they house the Jaegers and research the kaijus and all that for Pacific Rim. But we also want to kind of shadow through. Like, it's actually a reference to wanting to break through that kind of cult status sort of bubble that both Pacific Rim, Dark Crystal, and also the notion of games being just games. Like, we want to redefine that, and we have these things we hand out at Interactive Artistry called Testaments of Melioration. They're like these certificate type things in recognition of people who are actually out there wanting to actually shift that notion. And now I want to get alongside with you, Phil, to a point in the future where Dark Crystal, when you say that, you'll no longer think, oh, that 80s cult movie. You'll think, oh, whoa, Dark Crystal, can't wait for the next movie to come out, can't wait for the next series to come out, or the next figure to come out, which is really where, as you've been interviewing, you know, the McFarlane people, and then with Age of Resistance, like, that is shifting, and I do not exaggerate, man. Like, you're part of the forefront of that, gathering the sort of nodes of increasing. And I see that the numbers as well going up. It's such a great sign, you know, the Dream Fasting Facebook group. Seeing people, gathering together, gathering songs. It's a perfect name as well for that one, by the way. But yeah, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I was just saying, yeah. I mean, Gathering Songs was sort of very influenced with the name. I think the Gelfling Gathering. And so it's just sort of a combination, just sort of mixing those words around, well, using gathering, and then songs is sort of a term that's sort of in Dark Crystal lore. It's sort of, songs are pretty much like stories in a way.
When I read it, it just sounded like a term from the stories, like directly from Mr. Henson. Like, that's something he would have written in maybe the earliest, like 1974 draft. Like, oh yeah, and the Gelflings, you know, and their gathering songs came together to tell the story of the like, it just flows really well. Yeah. So again, a sign of a symptom of your connection with this material, man, for sure.
Yeah, and I mean, like, and Dream Fasting, yeah, I mean, that is one of the, you know, it's such a great Facebook group for all discussions on the Dark Crystal. So, I mean, if any of your listeners, if you, you know, love the Dark Crystal and, you know, very interested in, you know, checking out some more sort of discussions among, you know, the group members, it's definitely worth checking that out, which I think you could just do. So if you just search for Dream Fasting, the Dark Crystal Experience, it should appear in the top search results. Yes, yes.
And we'll be linking all of your outlets, my friend, in all the descriptions for all the episodes. Actually, that segues us perfectly. So, listener, you clicked on this video or clicked on this podcast episode, you saw Make This Exist, a Dark Crystal open world RPG. That is why I have here Phil today. And it is the first of this sub-series, which we are kicking off with Phil, we are going to just take the time to basically turn on the mind's eye cinema and just talk about something that in all meanings of the word, like, should exist, that we already probably have it in our minds fully fleshed out and we're just quoting from it because, like, I can so see it. I just can so see, like, a Witcher / Skyrim / Dragon Age level, you know, using all the kind of current gen technology, you know, even photogrammetry. Buddy, can you imagine, like, seeing maybe one day you're on YouTube and you just click a thumbnail and you'll just see it there? It's like Brian Froud and CD Projekt Red, you know, he goes to their studio and he supervises the photogrammetry scanning of the original, Dark Crystal puppets and props so that they can be recreated in this engine, the Witcher 3 engine. Like, doesn't that just, like, just the thinking of that, just, it's such an interesting and like, it should be like, why doesn't it exist, Phil? Please tell me why not.
That's the thing with the Dark Crystal. I mean back when the film came out, I mean, there was only the you had the game on the, I think it was called on the Apple 2, I think, which you can actually play that game on darkcrystal.com. It is one of those things, is like, why there hasn't been a video game, you know, for something like the Dark Crystal. It's, I think probably now is sort of probably the more perfect time more than ever, just because of, with the Jim Henson Company re-establishing the Dark Crystal, now that we've got this Age of Resistance that's going to come out. So I think, when the show comes out, there's going to be a lot of interest for Dark Crystal. And I mean, you know, the video game, it definitely has a lot of potential.
Yeah, and listening, so with this, we're obviously not just going to go off the handle, just talk about it like in an unstructured way. We actually do. We have the sort of five categories of sort of what a game is. We have gameplay, we have world building, we have like design, we have just like the staff that we'd want to see. So we're going to have a sort of loose structured approach to discussing each of the sort of headers. And what I'll even have a crack at, in the description later is, with the back of the box. I think I talked to you about this, Phil. Have a crack at just like literally describing what the game will be. And anyone out there who's a big fan of doing kind of a mock or like alternate back covers or stuff like that for like DVD covers or Blu-ray covers, like, get in touch. I'd be happy to, like, again, put this thing out there so that, like, it'll come across in image searches. The internet is this magical kind of web way of, like, one thing going to another. And if just by putting this episode out there, we in any way contribute to the collective mind share of people who want to see this happen, and if people can even, not tooting our own horn or anything, but just like if they may possibly, like, later reference this episode later when sort of saying, oh, well, you know, some of the things these two guys kind of riffed with, that could be cool and that could work. So we're going to approach it from all angles, and just thought I'd let the listeners know as that. And yourself, Phil, just so that we're not just like, wouldn't this be cool? Wouldn't that be cool? Because, like, we're not going to get anywhere there. We want this to be, like, constructive and actually properly contribute and form, like, almost like a document of, like, how this could feasibly work. So you mentioned the game that, like, again, you can just play it. It's like a flash thing. It's like, it came out at the time. Oliver Harper, actually, he did a great job. Hoping to get him at one point to get him onto the show as well to discuss some, because when he dives into his retrospectives, he always talks about the games of things. And leading on from this, like, there's going to be a whole bunch of, like, I've already started growing the whole Make This Exist kind of list, and I've run into a few movies that he's covered that I'm sure he would be able to speak to, like, how a game could sort of take shape around that. And then Phil, oh my god, you have to come on to, like, any of Interactive Artistry's other shows to discuss stuff there as well. You're definitely welcome. But yeah, for sure. So there was that game made, and then we just recently had, and you have a bit more, actually, I don't know if you wanted to announce it yet, but some news relating to the board game that it just came out. So again, very timely with us doing this chat today. As we know, before we had digital, we had pen and paper, you know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
Exactly. So, and there's a precedent for, like, you know, something having grown into, like, Fallout, for example. I believe that I'm not sure quite. I mean, it may have been retroactively adapted, but here's the thing: it's a known thing that when pen and paper is made, it can form part of setting the blueprint for something digital. So, have you played it? Have you spoken with any of the people involved with the making of the board game?
So, I mean, with the board game, I had bought it, I think, about a week or so ago. And, I mean, at the moment for me, you know, I've just been playing it by myself, just sort of trying to understand the rules of the games and, with the board game. Because, I will say, like, you know, the sculpts and the board game sort of layout is pretty, pretty fantastic. But yeah, I mean, like, probably the only thing probably at the moment that's, you know, that there is a lot of rules, and I was just having a look at how many pages there was, and there's at least like 24 pages of rules, so it's a lot to sort of get through. And I mean, like, and I do play like some board games on the occasion, I'm not an active board game player. I think most of my occasions that I do play board games would be whenever I'm at PAX, which is the exhibition at the Melbourne Exhibition Centre that always happens towards October of each year, which is a fantastic exhibition. So yeah, I mean, like, it's just sort of getting my head around it, but I think I'm sort of almost getting to a point where it's like, okay, I could probably get some people to start playing it with. I can probably talk about it on here, but I'm hoping to have some of the people who worked on the board game, Alessio Cavatori, who was the game design of the Dark Crystal board game, and I think his previous works was through the Golda Games Workshop, those kind of tabletop games, which is awesome to be able to have him on the show to chat about the Dark Crystal board game. And I'll have Johnny Fraser Allen on the show down the track as well, and he did the sculpts of all the four characters, and I think he did some art design with the board game as well, which is pretty cool. So they're the two, they'll be on the show, and I can't wait to hear more about, you know, how they got the board game happening. And it's just a very exciting time.
It is. I was just about to say,
to be a man at the Dark Crystal, yeah.
It's so good. And look, here's the thing, like, we're all aware of, you know, it's very easy to lapse into kind of being a bit jaded with when you sort of think of, oh, look, algorithms and like trend setting and stuff, and like, well, we're in the middle of an 80s nostalgia thing, and so have your fun at celebrating this, but just so you know, it's so that it's pandering and like making money. Again, when you're a kid, like, Phil, let's just jump back a couple, maybe decade and a bit. As kids, you just don't care. This doesn't even register that politics stuff. Am I right? Like, you don't spend any amount of time thinking about how something came to be, what the politics was behind it, the business deals that were arranged. You're just there, cross-legged, in front of an old square TV, in you and my case. Maybe the kids nowadays.
Yeah.
But we're there, cross-legged, in front of the square TV with our milk and our cookies, and we're watching this thing. And that's all it is, you know, we don't. And so for me, immediately when I see something announced, like, for example, the recent Solo trailer, I immediately just like, I dropped all pretense of adult jadedness, all pretense of like, oh, look at them trying to squeeze at the story. Oh, do we need this? I just like, I mute that very internet-centric kind of attitude. And I shrink down from however I'm 6 feet. I shrink down to like a couple feet. high and just back to 10-year-old Albert, and I'm like, this is phenomenal. And I let myself, I was walking to work, walking to like lunch, and I just, audibly, like, I just did that thing of like both hands bunched up, just like almost leapt into the sky, and I just started running, like Trevor Jones music in my head, you know, like, it's just like that's what, like, what other way is there to live with this stuff? And I'm sure, like, how has it been for you in your experience with like needing to balance out, like, oh, this is great, the Funkos and everything, the merch and all that, and it's very easy to just be like, well, that's just to make money. But like, how do you stay in touch with that kind of inner child, man, when it comes to the Dark Crystal?
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'm always pretty, try to be, you know, pretty positive with all things Dark Crystal, you know, regardless, you know, if there are things that that some fans, you know, really despise or things that they love. But I try and keep an open mind about it. And I mean, like, for me, at the end of the day, sort of, more Dark Crystal is sort of better than none at all. So, and especially, you know, I know people have, you know, have concerns about whether it's, you know, with the show or even with the comics, with Power of the Dark Crystal. But yeah, I mean, yeah, but I'm sort of happy that at least, you know, that the Jim Henson Company, that they actually, they're doing something now, with the franchise. And I mean, it's sort of, it's been a very slow sort of, journey to bring the Dark Crystal back in a big way, which really just sort of started. I mean, you had the film in 82, but then sort of in the 90s and early 2000s, not a lot really happened. And, it wasn't really till, I think, 2012, when they started doing these graphic novel series of books called Creation Myths, which sort of delve into sort of the backstory of pretty much almost like the prequel to the Dark Crystal. So you sort of get to know how the Earth Skeks, these alien creatures that came to Thra, how that happened, and how the splitting, how they got split up into the Mystics and the Skeksis and so much more. So
And the way that I, another analogy that I use is, so like Star Wars right now, like consider that like the big lounge where everyone is just partying super loud, you know, and there can be some fascinating conversations that can be had, some nuance there, but it's in essence a really, and this isn't like an elitist kind of thing of like, oh, you know, or a hipstery kind of thing. Like, so that is the main room, and that's true. And in many ways there have been things with like, you know, that, you know, other franchises have sort of benefited from, you know, like the sort of main room, as I call it. What I consider the crystal to be is not like the attic, not the basement, but just an adjacent room that is increasingly like people like poking their heads in, and that there's this really, and it's like a little bit quieter, but you can hear people better because of a bit of it being a bit quieter. And I, and I, and also because of that intimacy, the conversations, like, for example, you recently interviewed Cheryl Henson. Jim Henson's daughter. And so that's, I love that. And it's almost in some ways like preferable sometimes to some of the kind of louder kind of, you know, sort of places on the web with this sort of thing. And so, yeah, what are your thoughts on that, on like Dark Crystal just being almost like this cozier kind of, just like, yeah, it's still, it's growing, but that kind of a feel. What do you reckon, man?
Yeah, I'm just trying to think, like, yeah, like I sort of just, yeah, to keep a, you know, to keep an open mind, but I think, you know, it's just it's such an exciting time that I think, you know, regardless of the outcomes of, you know, with future stories, whether they're not good or not great, that, yeah, like, you know, they'll be good.
Did I answer that question?
Yeah, you totally did. Yeah, you gave your sort of riff on it. By the way, I'm, you know, in the meantime, just like while I'm recording, I'm always like putting together notes and stuff. I'm just looking at this beautiful, like, the Jim Henson's The Dark Crystal Tales original graphic novel, like that artwork with you know, Jen with his pipe and Kira with the podlings, and they're all just listening to it. It's so beautiful, you know.
I do have that book, and yeah, it is a very nice sort of picture story book. You know, for kids, but also, you know, the kid in you, you know, as well. So, it's definitely worth, yeah, checking that out too. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, for sure. Well, why don't we crack on with our sort of the main sort of segment here, as in like the main kind of topic. So, the the easiest thing to do really at this point is just like when, if you were like sculpting something, you would have reference images around you, and then you would have an armature to sculpt on top of. So what we need to do, we need to pick and we need to talk about a few references about what would really actually honestly work for Dark Crystal that we have available, so that we can, again, just save ourselves the work. You know, you don't want to just start perfectly ground up. If you have things that actually do match up, start with those. And this is, by the way, former art student talking. Of course, I'm going to structure it this way. Yeah. But so if you had to pick an armature, if you were like, say, if this was like stop animation or something, if you had to pick the skeleton of a Dark Crystal open world RPG, what would you pick, Phil?
Yeah. So I mean, I sort of had thought about like, yeah, we've, you know, what the ideal sort of game developers. So, you know, I would love to do, you know, see it happen with this, you know, open world RPG game. And so, I mean, my top picks would be probably like the BioWare or Obsidian Entertainment. Of course, I mean, they're very well known for, I mean, it's probably one of my favorite video games, Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic. Which I know, I think BioWare, they did the first one and Obsidian did the sequel. And yeah. And then, of course, I mean, you got your Bethesda Game Studios, of course, you know, with Skyrim. So they're sort of like probably those two sort of, or three game developers that, you know, I would, you know, love to see them doing a Dark Crystal video game. But I mean, and I mean, that's the thing about thinking about this kind of video game that, you know, because I'm always sort of thinking now and then from a marketing point of view that, you know, the Dark Crystal is sort of, I mean, it's sort of a weird, very weird sort of, you know, who, you know, the target audience, you know, is it for children? Is it for adults? You know, it's sort of like an in-between sort of thing. So it's like to try and create a game that, that fans, you know, from the 18, you know, your typical 18 to 35 video game target audience are going, the demographic that they're going to love, but also something that the kids, you know, whether they're, you know, like 10 or 12 years old, will be able to sort of pick up and play it, you know, and enjoy it, that sort of thing. And that's the other thing is sort of like, if you're going to go not with a, you know, super realistic kind of graphics, then probably the only other example I could think of is with Nintendo, with The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. Like that, for me, that was just another example of you know, like the graphics, like they're not like super realistic or anything, but the art is just beautiful, and like I think, you know, I think that would be like a great alternative, you know, with that sort of art style, I guess. Yeah.
Now you just basically dropped like a massive mic, and there's no question, yeah, that as soon as you mentioned, by the way, anything you mention, I'll cut away to a little bit of a clip there of just like music and stuff. Just again, when you mentioned,
sure,
yeah. So Breath of the Wild, like, yeah, talk about like the shedding of adult jadedness. I had several moments throughout playing that where I had that just like, and it's, you know, make the argument of like, you know, I don't ever consider it like super oversharing or anything, but I do, I'm very free with how like something makes me feel kind of emotionally kind of thing without, again, or dipping into like, oh, sensitive new age guy kind of shit. It's just about how it literally made me feel. And I'm like, fucking ex-army tattooed all you want, but when I fucking played this thing, which, by the way, I used to play Twilight Princess in the army to kind of escape a little bit, because I just, it wasn't it wasn't congruent with who I was. So I sit down to play this Zelda, which I grew up with Ocarina, and I sit down for Breath of the Wild, and I had to take regular breaks of just like fucking being able to like process how like perfect the game was, and how and this is really like crucial to Dark Crystal, because what the opportunity is here is like with Breath of the Wild, it just felt like the ultimate fulfillment of what Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask and all the subsequent titles, like it just felt like the fulfillment of what Zelda is. And what's great with what we have here with Age of Resistance coming up and everything, and the proof that we're going to see, Phil, it's all coming together. I kid you not. Like Marvel, what they're doing now is they're not doing the tie-ins anymore. They're saying, look, we saw Rocksteady, we saw what they did with Arkham. We've seen that like a property and a story always functions better when you get the exact right people for it, and you don't just like throw something together for a quick buck on the brand and like within the release window. It's like Arkham was coming out, like it came out completely staggered from Dark Knight. Dark Knight came out in 2008, I believe. Yeah. Arkham came out in 2009, so they didn't care about releasing them at the same time. However, now, no. Phil, just to give you the idea, we use Arkham as a phrase now, just like Metroidvania, just like Zelda-esque. We say, oh, look, this is the Arkham of this, which goes to show that when a development company, and this is what, as I mentioned, Marvel are doing, they're saying, no, we're going to get Insomniac to do the Spider-Man game. We're going to get Capcom to do this. We're going to get this. So they're branching out. And what I want, obviously, if this makes its way into the sort of ear holes of any devs, just like realize that like you have a perfect opportunity here to take, just put together, I'll help you put together the presentation of give me this from Breath of the Wild, give me this from, and I'm going to talk about this personally, is Crystal Chronicles. Which was a Final Fantasy game, which is, you look at the Yooks, they're essentially a mixture of Skeksis, and not in the Urskek kind of way, but they have the Skeksis kind of like jaggedness, but then they also have the Uru, very kind of gentle kind of vibe to them. So I'll send you some artwork of those guys. So put those two together. Exactly. So, but the thing is, like, what's great about this is sometimes, oh, it's fun to sort of wildly speculate and sort of dream at the wind and never really with the idea that anything will come about, but buddy, we live in an age where, like, because of, you know, we live in an age of resistance, so to speak. Like, we resisted kind of thing to the idea of this, like, falling off. And I think that may have possibly formed why they called it that, is, like, maybe, I don't know, maybe in some behind the scenes we'll find out. But we live in a time where people are, like, they're putting things out there because of demand. Like, we're getting a Witcher TV series because of, like, the tracking, so to speak. So, like, the internet can actually make kind of like dreams come true in a way. So so there's a very real possibility that what we're talking about could very much, like, you know, end up coming to fruition. So sorry to jump in there with your tangent on Breath of the Wild, but you can even go into what specifically about Breath of the Wild you'd like to see incorporated in running around as a little gen, as a little Gelfling, like floating around, you know, open world Thra. Go for it.
Yeah, I mean, like, with Breath of the Wild is, I think it's just the art of the game. The art style is what I really like. And I mean, I know, like, in Zelda games, that there's always been some controversy about, you know, what kind of art style. Because I vaguely remember, I think, the Wind Waker at the time was pretty controversial because of it's too cartoony, it's not serious, that sort of thing. And of course, later on down the track, they went back to sort of that sort of realistic graphics with Twilight Princess. And it's funny with that game, is like years later, I think people, you know, there's a lot of Zelda fans that actually love The Wind Waker. And it's always cool to have sort of, you know, different art styles. Like, you know, I'm not like, you know, oh, it has to be definitive like this. I guess I'm, you know, pretty open. But I think, like, if it's anywhere between sort of the Zelda style, with Breath of the Wild as probably a prime example, to, you know, what you get, you know, with Skyrim, would be very awesome. Yeah.
And then, yeah, you know, like, obviously we're not, I won't use the phrase beggars choosers or anything. That's silly, but I will say, just from a flexibility point of view, I would obviously be happy to see anything like the Stranger Things app. Yeah. You know, Stranger Things, the app game, for example, that was released for free. That's just as welcome, you know. And I don't know. I listened to the full Cheryl interview. I don't think you guys dipped into what games might come about. I can't remember. Did you touch on any of that with her?
I don't think so. No.
That's okay. Well, that's the thing, you know, things are really in a way just beginning to kind of, it's the second great conjunction kind of thing. It's like things, it's the 80s again, as they say, things have come around, a cycle has been completed, and we are in Stranger Things season 3 being developed now. We're in, you know, in The Last Jedi, extensive use of puppetry and constant tipping of the cap to Henson's designs and a return to practical effects in this big way. So Age of Resistance very much a symptom of that, but I don't think it's not going to end there. Like, what we're going to see, buddy, like, is Netflix is, it's a parlance now. Oh, Netflix and chill, whatever. It's a household term now. This is probably the healthiest thing that could have happened to Dark Crystal. You know, it really is, like, this particular platform, like, even like a movie to an extent you can ignore. It's like, oh, that's coming out, movies are dying, that, you know, they, there's an argument that's being made for it, at least with the movie pass. It's like, oh, well, you know, theaters, that's not the future. Streaming, like, it's so brilliant on a strategic level that Age of Resistance is happening this way, and it's probably like the best way that anything going from Age of Resistance in terms of games, which I we're talking probably your opinion on this, we probably only really would see like an open world game after Age of Resistance, do you think?
Yeah, I would definitely think so at this case, because I mean they are shooting the show like right now, which I think wraps up, which I'm led to believe it actually wraps up sometime in August. And I think, you know, for them to work on a video game, they would have had to start working on it probably since late last year. You know, if they were going to really try and do like a tie-in sort of video game with Age of Resistance. But I feel like, yeah, I definitely feel like it'd be after, when Age of Resistance comes out, and once sort of it builds so much interest, and I'm sure, like, you know, the Jim Henson Company and Netflix, you know, they'll have their statistics of, you know, how many people watch this and watch that, which is probably the interesting thing with Netflix, is like, we actually don't get, you know, the ratings sort of thing that we get, you know, with, you know, free to air TV, which is very interesting sort of. So all their statistics are very kind of private, though I do recall, I think they actually posted something about like with Cloverfield Paradox that came out, and I think they had 5 million people watched that film, which is
am I right? Like, that's amazing. And again, it's a guaranteed thing. It's like, you know, it will come up for people maybe searching for Star Wars. Oh, do you want to check out Dark Crystal? And especially with some of this beautiful artwork, like the vinyl, for example, like that's some of the most beautiful artwork I've seen done of the Dark Crystal. You know, with the Uru to the left in profile, and Jen and Kira to the bottom right, the Skeksis right up there, the twin suns. So immediately seeing that, someone being like, I've never heard of the Dark Crystal before. And then the journey begins. You know, on YouTube, looking at documentaries, you know, finding your podcast, and, you know, like, then possibly locating this episode, you know, tangentially from that, all the other communities around there, you know, which are, I tend to think of them kind of in a way, in a non-lame way, kind of thing, like disparate tribes that, you know, that I need to emphasize how great the wording of Gathering Songs is, buddy. Like, well done. Thanks, yeah. Because, you know, again, it's like the Facebook group is great for that. I believe you guys are the largest Dark Crystal community on the web.
Yeah, I mean, there is a couple of Dark Crystal fan groups out there with Facebook. But yeah, I will say, yeah, Dreamfasting is probably the most active out of them all. Like, every day there's always, you know, someone posting you know, things on that site, whether people are posting, chatting about the comics or something that's coming soon, or they'll discuss about you know, with Age Resistance if any news sort of comes out by then. And I think you know, at the moment, a lot of people are, you know, as of this recording, we're all very excited to see the Dark Crystal coming back on the big screen, which is, I know it's in US cinemas.
I know.
For 4 days. So
let's just hold the candle up as two Australians who are just like, oh, shit. That would be great.
I know.
And I know in the past, like, there had been screenings of the film through Cinema Nova. They did a bunch of them one time a couple of years back. And I think the Astor Theatre, they used to do at least a screening a year.
Hey, if anything happens, it's going to be Melbourne. Yeah. You know that. And I'm going to come visit.
Yeah.
I'll swing by later. Hey, yeah, we talked about it. Swinging by later the year to play the... if you're available, let's definitely get the board game happening, man. That'll be good.
Yes, totally.
for sure. Well, I'm just going to bring up, you know IGN, like the site that does kind of all the game reviews and stuff?
Yeah.
Like those guys, yeah. So what they have at the end of all of their reviews, they just have, like the sort of breakdown of categories and stuff. So it's almost like, I don't know if you've ever thought this, but when thinking about how something's going to turn out, I kind of think of what would be the perfect review to give this, and then just work backwards and make the thing that produced that would produce that review, you know. And so I kind of think of it that way. So but with this I have obviously the ending verdict. So the ending verdict for me for something like the Dark Crystal podcast, mm-hmm. the Dark Crystal RPG would be like,
yeah.
It took the best of like Breath of the Wild, the world exploration, the puzzle solving, but it tightened the experience in the same way that The Witcher did, you know, while still remaining open. It combined like the quest lines and the sort of sub quests and side quests of Dragon Age Inquisition, and then it mm-hmm. wrapped it all up in this beautiful kind of aesthetic that evoked the best Final Fantasy titles, like Final Fantasy IX and Final Fantasy Crystal Chronicles, which in a cyclical cool kind of way took a bunch of inspiration as well from Dark Crystal. And in fact, like, you know, as a little side note, you know, the whole Tsinch, that sort of deity of change or whatever, that's totally Skeksis from Total War right now, mm-hmm. which is the Total War Warhammer guys. It's all over the place, and they've even referenced them. I spoke with Paul Jaycock, who designed the Noblars, who are they're kind of the sort of little mini kind of goblin militia of the ogres, which you'll see definitely down the line. They're going to get some DLC happening for that particular RTS, the Total War Warhammer 2. He said, I was directly influenced by Brian Froud. So, that's kind of, and I want to see, that's kind of my idea of what the review would kind of look like, it would have to be a 9.5 or something like that. Just like they knocked it out of the park kind of thing. But we can even speak in kind of flashes if you want. We're going to go through all, obviously, the categories, but what would you want out of the gameplay of, like, let's just talk just gameplay for a while, of something like the Dark Crystal? Would you like something more of like a platformer or something more alongside like the Arkham series, where it's like there are some platforming elements, but it's more about like that third person exploration? What would you like to see, Phil?
Yeah, I'm probably leaning towards sort of the Arkham sort of, I mean, definitely sort of the third person perspective, playing it as a Gelfling sort of character and sort of exploring the world of Thra. And I think one of those things, like with the, what's cool about, I mean, so it depends on with the time period of with, you know, for a video game like this, I mean, if this game sort of, if the time period is sort of during sort of the Age of Resistance era, or, you know, in between the second or the third Great Conjunction, that was sort of the era that Gelfling clans sort of established.
My next question was going to be, when would you set it? That's perfect.
I would think probably in between the second and third Great Conjunctions, which you know, in Thra. So basically the second Great Conjunction, that was the moment where the Urskicks, these alien creatures, they sort of were attempting to go back to the homeworld, but all things sort of fall out of the way, and because of that, they split it up into the Mystics and the Skeksis. So that was the second Great Conjunction. And the third one is, of course, what happens in the Dark Crystal film. So you have like 1,000 years of 1,000 years of stories that you could tell throughout that time. And I think it's probably, and I think from like, probably from a storytelling point of view, that I think it's probably been more interesting, just because because that was the era where there's like 7 different Gelfling clans exist, or were created. And I'm just trying to think. And also, and I guess, you know, for nostalgia's sake as well, you know, so you have the so you have like the Skeksis and the Mystics, that sort of thing. And like, it's one of those things where it's like, I don't know how it would work as a game if you just had Gelflings, but you didn't have, you know, say it, the game took place, you know, after this, after the end of the film, or even before the Urskeks arrived. I don't know how well like that will work from a storytelling point of view when you don't have those Skeksis or Mystics. I mean you'd have to create like a new threat.
Exactly. You would have to have the Skeksis and Mystics. And this is me putting a little bit of my marketing hat as well on. It's just like, that's great. Lore integrity is super important, and there's a way of weaving everything together in a way that sort of fits and that honors all the sort of aspects. So it would have to be after obviously the Urskeks had split. But we would also need to see because if we wanted to accommodate something of that sort of third person sort of dark. So I keep saying dark crystal, which is great, that's fine. I am trying to say the word Dragon Age, and it's just like the Dark Crystal just takes over. It's like but in that Dragon Age kind of way of there being settlements, of there being fellow travelers, like again, a little vignette of this hypothetical game, which we hope obviously comes true, is, you know, you've got your pack on, just like a Link from Breath of the Wild, you're sort of going along, and then you come across like maybe a gang of podlings or like a caravan of podlings, and you talk with them, and they've been you know, waylaid or something, and they've lost one of their own, and then that sort of takes you into this sort of jungle, sort of you divert and into this sort of you kind of have to go on this sort of mini platforming quest, dive deep into see all those creatures that, you know, Kira, when we're introduced to her, we see a bunch of those, and then, you know, turns out that like either there's a twist in a sort of Witcher kind of way. It's not as simple as just rescuing them from a bush. Maybe they were like actually legitimately tried to run away because they find the caravan boring, or like we see some charming, endearing kind of story there, and then that might turn into its own little mini game or anything, or you might make a friend sort of there. That could be interesting, definitely. What do you think of having a party? Like you gather a party of Gelflings to sort of like a Final Fantasy style. Would you be interested in something like that? Or maybe one Gelfling, one Podling, and different species, or a Fireling?
I think it's possible to have, you know, multiple sort of Gelflings. You know, you could have one that represents sort of each clan. You know, as your party. So, I mean, you could have, you know, you could almost have one for each clan if you wanted to, or like, I mean, of course, you know, maybe start off with two or three, and then sort of, you know, when you go to each sort of, if, you know, the Gelflings are going to each clan, and it's like, oh, you know, join with me on this adventure and whatnot.
Oh, that's a great premise. You know,
they'll be like, yeah, let's do it.
Yeah.
Because like, I mean, I was just having a look at the different types of clans, and so you've got the Woodland clan, you've got the Spriten, the Drenchen, Vapra, Grotten, Sifa, and Dozan clans. And they're all pretty different. You know, ones from the woods, or Spritens are sort of like the warrior sort of race. And
it's almost Drenchen like the Avatar, you know, an Avatar. I don't know if you saw the Cirque du Soleil, but they did a it's very similar in a way, which, by the way, we have to mention it on this show, they're creating to come out with the 2020 film, they're going to be doing a, like, Ubisoft, they tapped into the people who did The Division, which is exactly what you and I are talking about, where they're going to go open world, you'll be able to jump in, and they're describing it as being able to live a second life on Pandora. I would love to be able to, like, live essentially like a second life on Thra. I want to like come across Phil Gelfling, you know, Filfling, and I want you and I to just be able to go on like quests and stuff. That would be awesome.
Yes, yeah, and like I mean, in each of these Gelfling clans, like they're all pretty different. They all do have their own sort of special abilities or whatnot. So I can sort of see them. I mean, originally, like I did thought about. Like if it was sort of more like, you know, you're just playing this one Gelfling character, and whether, you know, you had, whether there was the ability of, like, you know, yourself with which character you want to be. And then it's sort of like each sort of clan sort of has its own story at the start. And then sort of once all the clans are reunited, I don't know, say, I mean, I'll just say it's like something to do with age resistance, you know, they're all going to work together to take down the Skeksis or whatnot. And you had points of view of like each clan sort of had their own storyline, you know, at least at the start, and then at the start of the game, which sort of gives, you know, that replayability that you can play the game again.
Yeah.
As a different clan to get a different story. But I think that's probably a bit complex in my head.
Yeah, no, you that's know, okay.
I can imagine that might be a bit complex for the game developers. But I think even just having the party that you can just switch back and forth, you know, especially like with Star Wars: The Old Republic. I know well.
Yeah.
That's the only example I could think of on top of my head, where you can switch back and forth between the characters. And that'd be pretty cool as well.
That's
right.
Abilities. Let's talk branching kind of skill trees and stuff like that, and then classes as well. Because if we took this direction, which I think could be very appealing to people, the idea of, again, and this is great with the synergy of what will be happening around the time when this comes out, of like Avatar, where you're going to be able to create your own kind of, like Navi kind of thing. And so what I can see being really appealing is I'm speaking directly, I've got my eyes closed kind of thing, looking at it in my mind's eye, is the character creation screen of like you as a Gelfling, or developing kind of your features and stuff there, and, you know, doing the whole turnaround of like figuring out like your height and your length of your nose and all that kind of thing. And so then when you would think of, this is the same thing as Dragon Age. I'm getting there. I'm saying it less. I have to take the pause to make sure I don't say Dark Crystal. But yeah, the Dragon Age Inquisition creation screen is sort of that would be if I was there with the dev saying, okay, just take this, pretty much run with this. Like, go, I want you to have, turn the whole thing around. Species might be a bit of an issue because we don't, like, unless you're talking Fireling, which, again, it's like, we think, because, the Gelflings are the stars. So, again, I think we should, at least for the first game, talk about just Gelflings. But then you can obviously choose whether or not you're a male or a female. Which would obviously mean wings, obviously. Right?
Yeah.
And then being able to choose like class kind of thing. So again, Kira's if you had to put a class to Kira, by the way, listeners, as you may have read, or you'll definitely find this if you read the extended materials, like Gelflings aren't all just like Jen and Kira. Like, they're big butch Gelflings, there are like strong Gelflings, there are all kinds of different kinds, so you can be able to and like thin and wispy and maybe more proficient at magic, and it's like there's a lot of customization that can be done there. And I think Kira's perk, so to speak, would be Fizzgig, and like talking with animals and stuff and being able to summon animals, and that would be a skill tree that she would be able to develop, you know.
Yes, absolutely.
Have you played Horizon Zero Dawn by any chance?
No, I haven't, unfortunately. It is one of those games I've been meaning to. It's probably on my sort of wish list of games I need to play. But I mean, probably the game I've been playing a lot recently was the Middle Earth Shadow of War. Which is brilliant, brilliant. Such a fantastic game. Because I loved the first game with the Shadow of Mordor. I believe that's what the first Middle Earth Shadow of Mordor. Yeah, that's right. So that's that was the name of the first game. And me and my fiance.
Congratulations, by the way.
Thank you. Yeah, that's it's very exciting. We're going to get married sometime in September. So. Yeah,
oh, I'm of course I'll come. You don't have to ask me again. Of course I'll come to the wedding. I'm kidding, buddy. It's all right. We just met. It's all good. But needless to say, congratulations with that, dude. And
that's cool.
And and what I wanted to say is touching on what you're saying, you could not have mentioned a more perfect game, because what were we talking about with Arkham, and how like did they wait to, or did they try and coordinate the release of Shadow of Mordor with The Hobbit like extensively? No, they got the right developer, and I'll tell you how successful this was, man. You know, Ken Levine, he created BioShock. He is held up as one of like the main creative forces in this medium, you know. He introduced the whole thing. He really elevated the discussion of games as art, so to speak. That's a kind of very quick way to talk about it, but again, just deepening their aspects of like philosophically, emotionally, spiritually. So he's on that forefront. He said that his next game is directly inspired by the Shadow of Mordor and the Shadow of War. So there you go, right there. Like I could even see someone, if they, again, it doesn't have to be tied into Age of Resistance. It can, basically you talking about this is perfect, because that's a perfect touchstone with what we could actually see.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And it was just such a, it was such a brilliant game, with those two. And And even I just started playing the new DLC that came out for the Light of Galadriel. So just started playing it right now. But I can actually tell you, because I don't think it must have been in an update where it actually told you how many hours you played, you know, with the main campaign. And I was kind of shocked to see that. I think when I looked, we actually played like the main campaign. This is 100%. So we did everything. We did 621 hours.
Whoa! Holy shit! That's commitment, man.
Yeah, I know. My fiance. I mean, she probably played at least probably like I'd say 350, maybe 400 hours, and then I just played, the main campaign storylines, that sort of thing. But yeah, we were both kind of shocked, because that was it's almost pretty much the equivalent of playing the game 28 days straight, like 24/7.
Yeah,
but I do recall, like,
it's crazy. You're crazy, man.
Yeah, I know, and that's without like doing any
loot boxes, you know, like paying to get, you know, those the orc characters, you know, to build your armies and stuff. So yeah, we sort of did it old school, you know, the whole grinding process.
I had no idea. Well, now, like, this makes it so much easier because, you know, that one has skill trees as well. That one has a particular emphasis on communicating with and like bending others to your will and stuff. And again, we could talk a bit about the Kira aspect of, you know, I'm looking at the Dark Crystal Wikia now, like animal self-speaking, your ability to communicate with animals, command their loyalty, you know, which is literally what you're doing in Shadow of Mordor and Shadow of War. So that's perfect. Oh man, I could, this took a really awesome turn, because I had no idea that you were playing like a main game, and what an appropriate game, because we're talking about something that is an adaptation in a sense, but it's a great riff. Like, wouldn't you agree that you could put the protagonist, I believe his name is Talion, right?
Yeah,
you could put a voice by Troy Baker, by the way, legend. Oh, I'm gonna get him on the show one day for sure. Voiced like Joel and stuff in The Last of Us, really talented guy. So that whole endeavor of like making this thing which could feasibly, you take any character from that and they would fit perfectly in the films, you know, Talion, you could see, again, they didn't veer too far, they went a little bit stylistic with the characterization, but mostly photoreal, that everything, and then with Gollum in the first one, you can see that, like, yeah, they basically probably even used the Weta Workshop, like, models that they used, but, like, again, that's our new skeleton, that's our new reference point for this game, you know?
Yeah.
What would you take from that specifically, and that you're enjoying so much enough to play it with however many hundreds of hours you've played it, what would you take from Shadow of War into a dark crystal video game?
I'm just trying to really think, because I know, like, it'd be kind of weird, you know, if you had Gelflings that try and like try and get these like enemies to come join you and, you know, have their own armies sort of thing. But I think probably just the style, yeah, just that third person sort of, you know, exploring and because, yeah, I mean, it's a big world with Shadow of War. It's one of those things where it's like, I think I do prefer like the open world where everything's just like in the one area. Because I know, like, yeah, in Shadow of War that you do have to occasionally have to, you know, go out to the world map and you gotta, you know, what do you call it, fast track, I think I've got the term wrong, to go to, you know, yeah, fast travel, where it's like, you know, I would love it if, you know, with this Dark Crystal game, if it was all in the one world that, you know, you can able, that you could walk to it, sort of thing. I mean, much like Zelda in a way, or another example, you know, with Grand Theft Auto, with their games, how it's all pretty much, you know, it's all in the one sort of big map, so to speak, that I just feel it's just that immersiveness, to bring, yeah.
And if I'm not mistaken, there is a menu, which I think I had a few issues with the Shadow of Mordor, because I just wanted to be able to like do a bit more with it. And I think they could improve it with maybe they've even improved it with Shadow of War, but yeah, with definitely with the Dark Crystal sort of, yeah, we'll have to come up with some kind of name or something for it, you know, the subtitle. Yeah. Let's just call it the Dark Crystal open world RPG kind of thing. I would love to see an in-game encyclopedia / bestiary, which would be really great, because I know that they have something along those lines in Shadow of Mordor, where you can like look at all the sort of different plants and stuff that you've picked and like spin them around and like again in that sort of similar Skyrim way, because again something like that would be an opportunity to you know, collate everything lore-wise from darkcrystal.com that's referred to obviously in the films and in the comics, and it would just be more than just this opportunity of like the open world RPG kind of thing. It would be a great way of to condense and like the a similar way to, you know, Mad Max, that which is awesomely made by the Avalanche Studios. Did you play that one by any chance?
It is another one I need to
I'm gonna send you these codes. I'm just saying, Phil, not to like hype or anything, but we're going to be getting the exact same thing for Age of Resistance. Like, we'll see the cabinets with the new puppets. We're going to see the new... We're going to have new characters, new protagonists. And I can't even deal, man. It's really, really cool. And and I believe it is three Gelflings that series is following, correct?
Yes. So there'll be these three Gelflings that they discover the secrets of their Skeksis and what they're doing, and I think they'll just sort of do what they can to sort of stop them, and sort of I think probably the whole story is just probably getting all these different Gelfling clans to reunite to fight against them.
So from a synergistic point of view, I'm also again putting the marketing cap on, as well as just like you want everything to succeed. So less marketing, less marketing, more like strategy. And so what I would say with the hypothetical game, you know, 2019, I would let Age of Resistance kind of release, do its thing, and then as Age of Resistance, you know, the pop, you know, the vinyl pops are coming out, the merchandise. You know, it's getting on the news and everything. It's in IGN getting these ratings. You know, I just binge watched all of Age of Resistance. Now I'm a full blown, Dark Crystal fan. Like it expanded the mythos so much, and now I'm diving in, and this like it's elevated the original work so much more, and it's really given the promise of, you know, especially with the new technology that they were able to fit in so seamlessly with the puppets. Like the world of Thra has just been blown open, and this is everything that I was looking forward to leading up to Power of the Dark Crystal. Is combining some elements of very subtle photoreal CG to allow like just the world to just explode outwards, because what we've seen now, the biggest obviously source of the most immersive kind of source of Dark Crystal material we have now is the film, where it's just, you can see it kind of live action, you can see it right there, but it was very much contained to sets, and this is something that Cheryl talked about in your interview with her as well, that like while we did create a lot of things, we went to like two locations or something, it was mostly restricted to like matte paintings and this sort of thing. So to see that is going to blow open the scope. And after Age of Resistance has blown open the scope of Dark Crystal, that's when you tell someone, oh, you enjoyed that? Well, just thought I'd let you know that for a year or so, Rocksteady, the makers of Arkham, they've been hard at work making a Dark Crystal RPG. Here are the first few screenshots, and like that is boom, pinpointing it, man. That is exactly when you release that information, and then the excitement of Age of Resistance melds into the excitement of the new RPG, and then we see an E3 trailer, and Brian Fradd walks on stage. Okay, this is getting a bit like.
yeah.
Getting a little bit actually it's not too far-fetched, because we saw Final Fantasy X premiere or at least have this big event, this countdown event on the stage of the Oscars. Did you know about that?
No, actually, no.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, the little game that could from the 1987, you know, which was, by the way, came after Dark Crystal, Final Fantasy. There's no question that it had some inspiration from Dark Crystal in many ways, with that sort of element of the crystal there, central to the story and all that. And so we had Hironobu Sakaguchi, the creator of Final Fantasy. He had his face blown up like very, very large on the screen, you know, behind this sort of Oscar stage. And he was saying, oh, look how far, you know, the 30th anniversary, you know, Final Fantasy's come so far from us working about it in the 80s, you know, 30 years ago, and here we are. And I could see either a pre-recorded message by Brian Froud and maybe Cheryl Henson just be like, Jim, you know, he would talk about wanting to see more of this world and being like, knowing that the story itself was contained. It's like, I've nothing opposed to telling other stories. It's just like that's what he said. It's like, oh, the sequel really wouldn't work because this is kind of in a way like what happens, you know, like at the end kind of thing. But we would, he's like, I would not be opposed to seeing more stories told. And then Rocksteady come out and they talk about, well, we want to fulfill what Jim talked about, what the promise and premise of Dark Crystal would allow to happen. And then boom, right there, let's say E3 2019, sorry, E3 possibly 2020 gameplay, like a 10-minute gameplay video of you playing, of the person playing as like the Gelfling in the full open world. What do you reckon of that, man?
Oh yeah, it'd be fantastic. Yeah, if a just dropping another bomb of you know, here we got this new game in development, and because I was just thinking, you know, the whole video games. And I mean, this was something that sort of, I think Jim Henson sort of almost had these ideas about it. I'll just read a passage from Jim Henson, the biography. So during a trip to Hollywood to attend the Oscars, where Jim and Oz performed the Oscar-nominated Rainbow Connection, only to watch it lose the Best Song trophy to It Goes Like It Goes from Norma Rae. Jim and Lisa met with Sherry Lanson at 20th Century Fox to pitch their ambitious idea, a film in which the audience would be asked at intervals to choose the direction of the story. The mechanics were cumbersome, based on choices made by the audience. 72 different variations of the film were possible, but Jim was confident he could make it work. We were really interested in non-linear storytelling, recalled Lisa. We were really interested in non-linear storytelling, recalled Lisa. So this is Lisa Hansen, I'm presuming. The concept was you make a movie on a laser disc, and then a computer program would drive it to play different bits of the disc depending on what choice was made. But it wasn't possible to do it on a commercial filmmaking level. It would take another decade before the technology could catch up with Jim's idea. Really, where it all ended up was in video games, said Lisa. But we didn't know it at that time. And so, yeah, and it's just like, I mean, that was a thing with Jim, that he always had like hundreds of ideas in his head. And this was, yeah, like we were just talking about the whole, you know, video games, that I was just trying to bring up this, just a little passage from that Jim Henson biography that was written by Brian J. Jones.
That's awesome, dude. I really appreciate that. And so there you go, listeners. Like we have right there, you know, Jim was already, even back then, just thinking about not necessarily maybe directly a game, but just seeing how we could, how this world could expand and how the story could expand. And what he was describing really is a dialogue wheel. So any BioWare folk listening, yes. Either, you know, aficionados, the fan base of BioWare, or even developers. So like Henson was all over it. He's like, oh, and maybe this pretty much guarantees it for me, for any, Dark Crystal game to come out, it would have to have dialogue wheels, just to honor that particular passage which you just talked about, of like, how would the story branch out? And I think for that we would use Dragon Age. for that we would use Dragon Age for that one there. tell me, Phil, is that going to be another title I have to send you, as well as Horizon Zero Dawn and Mad Max? You haven't played Dragon Age Inquisition?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, for Christmas, for Christmas, I will be sending you these three games.
Fantastic.
So you send me like a PO box or something in an email or whatever.
Yeah, of course.
I hold myself to these things, man, so hopefully that'll you'll forget about it and then remember as soon as it arrives.
And just be amazed.
I dig it, man. Awesome. For sure. So there's my skeleton kind of for those things. I want open world definitely along the lines of Breath of the Wild, but tightening it up a little bit, because sometimes, as much as I love Breath of the Wild, there's just this tiniest bit of like desolateness, even though it's intentional because of the post-apocalyptic setting. That's very much suited with the particular era that we're thinking for Dark Crystal, where it wouldn't be too crazy. Like, it wouldn't be like villages everywhere. It's like the Podling village is very much like a sanctuary. And we've since seen maps and such of like Thra and like different settlements and such, haven't we?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
That's okay. We've since had in media, since obviously the films came out, and then like Power of the Dark Crystal, the graphic novel series kind of thing, the comics, and we since do have a map of Thra, like a more extensive one, that has settlements, tribe locations, and all this sort of thing, you know.
I think the maps have got it was very recently, I think, with the Shadows of the Dark Crystal, that in that book, I think in the hardcover. I don't know if they did it with the paperback. I definitely know, I think, in the iBook version, that it contains, like the map of Thra, which is really cool, just to sort of, get an idea. And I think, with the Dark Crystal, based on this planet Thra. But it's really, it's all in this, really, this one country called Skarith. And so like, we only know, probably 10-15% of the planet is probably Skarith. So there's a lot of possibilities of going beyond. I think it's Skarith.
That is very close. Ooh, look at you, Lucasfilm. You know, they named their planet Skarif with an F for Rogue One.
Yes. I know. It was one of those things where, when they announced that planet, I'm like, it sounds awfully familiar.
Get to Henson's lawyers on the phone.
Yeah.
Oh, well, then they have it again. Listeners, we know we talked about Dragon Age. There you go, I did it. I finally did it without saying Dark Crystal. So we talked about Dragon Age, but what they have is for the past couple titles, they've set them in different areas of Thedas, which is the Dragon Age world. By the way, you want a bit of trivia for the name Thedas, which is Thedas. That's the world of Dragon Age. The name just comes from the Das, which is DAS Dragon Age setting. They just, at one point, they didn't know what to call it. They were like, what do we call this damn world? Let's just call it the Dragon Age setting. So the Das, Thedas, you know?
Yeah, and I think so. The origins with naming the world Thra is it's pretty much an anagram of Earth, but you just take away the E.
Oh, that's perfect.
Yes.
I swapping trivia here. This has been trivia.
Yeah.
This has been your trivia podcast brought to you by. but that's awesome, and so listeners. So for the third Dragon Age for Inquisition, there was like discussion of like, where in the map will they set it? And the similar thing is happening right now with Elder Scrolls, as they're wondering, whereabouts are they going to, is it going to be Akavir, the land of the dragons? Is it going to be elsewhere, sort of thing, which is like the place where the Khajiit are from? So this is, again, there's a precedent definitely of like setting a game within a certain area. And in fact, my friend, we can think about this possibly in terms of creative titling, something evocative. So Dark Crystal, what is it called? The two dots. I did not succeed in English as a kid. What are they called? Not the semi, the colon. Okay. So Dark Crystal, colon, and then the area where that will be set. Do you maybe Valley of the Mystics or something evocative like that. That could be the name. How big is the Valley of the Mystics? It's probably pretty small, right?
Yeah, it is. I mean, I don't know if you've checked it out, but I actually discovered it like last night. And there was this it is on the Dark Crystal the Facebook page, the Trial by Stone, the Dark Crystal Podcast Network Facebook page, and I found this like 3D fan art of the Valley of the Mystics from the Dark of, you know, so
we can pause it if you want to check it out.
So I'll jump in and I'll probably include some of this in the bloopers. Valley of the Mystics. Valley of Mystics. 3D. And I can just type it in Google?
If you go to facebook.com/Dark Crystal Podcast, and it's the second post down.
Oh my god, what's going to happen
to my life? And I wrote, here's an impressive...
Oh my god. You are going to break my brain, dude. I need to clean up my room. I'm going to be cleaning up my brain all around this freaking room. Thanks a lot, man. I was hoping to be able to function today without you showing me amazing stuff. Okay, I know. All right, so okay.
I can give you the direct link. Hang on.
Oh, he's got the skills, the linking skills. Thanks, man.
Here we go. That might be better.
Here's the video introduction. Oh, yeah. nice video introduction. Oh, damn. Oh, here's an impressive 3D fan art. Okay. Oh, rest in peace for audio listeners. Oh my god. Phil, we're talking about this right now.
I know.
We're literally talking about this exact thing. When did,
yeah.
2 weeks ago. Okay. Phil, I had no knowledge of this, and then it was pretty much talk about great conjunctions. It was about 2 weeks ago that I invited you onto the show to do this. Yeah. So if you don't believe in all that kind of cool cosmic energy shit, I'll bleep this out. I apologize. Okay, Phil, am I offending you actually, by the way, by swearing? I actually want to stop.
No, not at all.
Yeah. But I will bleep, I promise. Okay, I'm playing this thing and I'm about to lose my shit right now.
How about we put this in the show and this could be your live reaction
Oh my god. I just can't even handle my life right now. And it's spinning it around and it's... Oh, damn. I'm so sorry, by the way. I hadn't seen this. Okay, this is literally how to make an Albert cry. You look in my Wikipedia article, is like, under like how to make this creature cry, it's like, oh, just play him this fucking amazing thing. Oh, and now it's becoming the polygons. Okay, listeners, and especially if you created this thing, you sexy beast, you... you need to get in contact. We need to interview you. We're gonna find some way of, like, on either of our networks, I'm sure, like, I'll do my best to get in touch with this person. So, Jose Luis Quiros, if you're out there, get the hell in touch. Accept a gigantic, awkward digital hug that's gonna squeeze the life out of you. I'm just gonna be hugging you intensely because you are part of what Phil and I are talking about right now on the air or on this recording.
Yeah.
Phil? That was amazing, and you are awesome, and I love you. This is fantastic. Are you kidding?
That's all right, no worries.
Are you kidding me right now? It's perfect.
I saw it last night, and if you look at the if you go to his username, there is another video called the fan art making of.
Okay.
It's pretty much the same clip at the start, but it just showed sort of a little bit behind the scenes towards the end.
That's brilliant. That's brilliant. And is this like it's just another area of Thra? Is this the swamps or something? Oh, no, that's another area.
Oh, no, yeah. Yep. It's the same thing, but if you...
Yeah, okay.
I think it's just like an extra 30 seconds more.
Yeah.
With the modeling.
Yeah, well, I'm officially dead right now. I don't know if you expected... Go ahead, Phil.
Yeah, it just came to my mind just because you were mentioning about what the scale of the Valley of the Mystics was, and I'm like, oh, wait, yeah.
Bring
that up.
Yeah, so I don't know if you're expecting to be able to speak with someone cogent and like intelligible on the rest of this podcast, but I'm dead now, man. I'm dead. But needless to say, that's brilliant. It's very much just throw that in your pitch video. Anyone listening to this, if you want to cut clips out of what Phil and I are saying, feel free. Like if you want to if you're putting something together for a dev, because this is how things happen. You put together a pitch video, you know, set up petitions, do whatever you need to. We're happy to. I'm speaking for myself, but I don't know. Obviously, extending this to Phil, because Phil gives voice to these amazing people creating Dark Crystal. I'm sure, needless to say, that you would be interested in speaking with possibly a dev that may hear this and say, "Oh, let me share what I'm attempting, or share my fan out that I hope constitutes maybe like a teaser trailer of something that a bigger studio can then take and create something bigger from." Would you be happy with someone listening to this and maybe getting in touch with you, Phil?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Like, I'm open, you know, they can take out, you know, my ideas or whatever.
Have this in recording, absolutely. Clip this out if you need to, as proof. Like, we're just putting this out into the ether. We're claiming no, like, oh, you know, we're gonna rock up later when the thing exists and say, oh, they stole our idea. This is no one's, this idea. This idea belongs to thousands and millions of people who are just daydreaming of this every day. We're just giving it voice, so there's no copyright crap or anything like that. I need to throw this at you. You saw Last Jedi, I take it?
Yes, I have. Yeah.
How about them Fathias, boy, with them giant long freaking strider legs? Look at that. Did you see that?
Yeah. Oh yeah. They were pretty cool. Yeah. But I mean, I loved the porgs. They're so cute. And been getting. I was just saying that being buying into the porgs, you know, the pop vinyls, and it was even like one of those what do you call them, those lucky boxes sort of things, trying to think of the name, they're not lucky boxes, loot boxes, yeah, and you had, you know, you and the one with the porg was like, you know, very hard to get, and I chose the box and opened it up, and then out came the porg.
Nice. Like, oh, so good. Also, they need to rename it to Lucky Boxes in honor of you, Phil. Lucky Boxes, mate.
Yeah. I just wanted to get the nickname, you know, this is Lucky Phil. Which is something from a TV show, a variety show, I think, Hey, It's Saturday.
I love that. Pluck a duck.
Yeah.
Pluck a duck, baby.
Pluck a duck, yeah.
Ride and die. Freaking David Strassman.
Not a chicken or a cat.
Yeah, that's right. But yeah, these Fathias, you know, these long-legged creatures. I riding this thing myself. It's called the Quantum Myth, and it's about, you know, it taps into a little bit of Dark Crystal with this. There's this observatory scene and everything, and there's this the notion of like it's the story's entaf, and it's like sentient metaphors. That's what ent from sentient and taf from metaphors. So these creatures called entafs, what they do is they're essentially like they're reflections in this other world, say Narnia, the Wizard of Oz, whatever have you. They're reflections of something, of like a friendship or relationship. So when two people like you and your fiance have an entaf in this world that is like this creature that combines both of your energies, and if you have like a more lion-like energy and she has a more stag-like energy, then this creature will resemble like a lion that has like antlers, you know, like that's the kind of thing. So when I saw this creature, I immediately thought of Dark Crystal, and immediately thought of, as well as Quantum Myth and stuff, this creature which so looks like a Jim Henson creation. It so looks like something that is a mixture of these different creatures, and it made me excited for the and I want to talk to you about it, the creature creation contest. So I believe that's closed now, the Dark Crystal one. Am I right?
Yeah, that's right. And I think on my episode with chatting to Cheryl Henson. They actually had a lot of entries. I think they had over like 3,000 entries with this Dark Crystal creator creature for the Dark Crystal Age of Resistance. And so I think right now they must be still going through all those entries. And I'm sure like there'll be an update on who won and I think it's, you know, I think that's a cool thing that what Jim Henson Company. That what they've been doing is actually, you know, getting sort of fans involved in some way, and that's kind of happened, you know, with their contests, especially with the author quest, with JM Lee, you know, when he won, you know, he got to write Shadows of the Dark Crystal, and then of course he worked on the sequel Song of the Dark Crystal, but he actually got on board with the Dark Crystal Age of Resistance as one of the sort of staff writers, or at least part of the writing team. So there's a lot of that synergy that they've been creating, and I guess like with fans as well. I think there was other contests that people are like with the fan film contest, and Kristen who won that contest, who does a lot of sort of costumes or like all that kind of stuff, and she's been working on the show as well, so which is pretty cool. Yeah,
it really gives you this feeling, man, that more than pretty much any other kind of property, community, world, IP, whatever, that or just like story kind of thing, that there's this intimacy between the creators and the community. That there's very few lines drawn between the two, that the lines sometimes blur, in fact, and one becomes the other, so to speak, of you know, these fan contests, and that I really feel in a really important way, which, but by the way, again, not disparaging Last Jedi, but let's just say that there was a disconnect in some cases between the fan expectations and what Star Wars meant to like a huge part of the community there, and then the direction that they took. It's important to take risks, absolutely, but it also Dark Crystal is proof that by communicating with your fan base and your community, you can create something that literally does both. It breaks new ground, it takes risks, but it also incorporates their feedback, and so that you can do both, you know. And I think that process would have to extend absolutely in the creation of a game. And Jose, who made this amazing demo, this sort of Valley of the Mystics thing, he needs to be in those conversations. He just has to me. It's incredible that there is that sort of interfacing between creator and community. So, but yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Mm. I have one more question for you, man, because I also want to recognize time. We're over the hour and 30. How are we doing for time?
I could probably chat. Yeah, I could probably chat for another like 20 minutes. Just to wrap it up. Yeah, totally.
Too easy. Okay, well, let's fire off a few things. So I'm going to go hot take, okay? Is that cool? So
yeah, go.
Landstrider Racing, we need to have this in the game as a mini game, correct?
Yeah, that'd be pretty awesome. I mean, you know, because I mean, you could eliminate sort of the fast travel, and you know, have them sort of, you know, if they're able to go at an incredible speeds, I think that would be kind of cool. And I think, like, as a fan, if I was, you know, playing the game, I'd probably just rather ride on the Landstriders, you know, along Thra, than, you know, taking the fast travel route.
Absolutely agreed. Now we need to get your thoughts on voice acting. Would you want voice acting? Would Jen's original act, I'm not sure who that awesome gentleman would be, but able to return, or would you want to see voice acting in this game?
I would definitely like voice acting in the game. I know that's probably the one thing that's really unique with The Legend of Zelda, how sort of, you know, Link, he never talks, that sort of thing. But I feel like, I don't know, for a game like The Dark Crystal, I feel like that, you know, everyone's got to talk or have their own sort of, you know, to be able to speak. So I'm definitely up for voice acting. And I mean, like, I think Stephen Garlick, who did the voice of Jen. And I mean, if I did do a game that took place, say, like, yeah, after the events of the Dark Crystal, and it's like him and Kira and probably Fizzgig or whatever, because at that point of time, they're trying to sort of restore the Gelfling, I'm pretty much led to believe that there'll be some Gelflings that are sort of out there that, thought that they were all wiped out, but they try and find them and sort of, you know, rebuild sort of the Gelfling civilization to bring them back to Thra. Yeah.
Okay, that's a locked in for me. As we go down our list, we need to get Steven back. Yeah. And the actress who played Kira, what was her name?
So Kira was voiced by Lisa Maxwell, and who's more very well known for her work on The Bill, that British crime or police series. So she did the voice of Kira, and yeah, I mean, like, I'd be interested, you know, to see them reprise the roles,
you know, like with like you know, how they've been doing with, for example, Sigourney Weaver. She reprised her role as Ellen Ripley for the Alien Isolation DLC, you know.
Yes, yeah, yeah, which is pretty awesome to see them back, you know, sort of reprising their roles. And I mean, that's going to be the interesting thing with Age of Resistance, because I know, like, I mean, with Olga, who was voiced by Billy Whitelaw, and of course, I mean, she's unfortunately not with us anymore. And there's going to be probably a couple of characters with Age of Resistance where the voices might be a little bit different to what we remember from the film. So, but yeah, I mean, the voice acting, I think, is pretty essential. And I think these days the voice acting is just fantastic, like with animation and also with video games.
And so now we're going to talk about a bit of Assassin's Creed. What we have here is, we don't want a parkour simulator, and I don't think Gelflings definitely very dexterous kind of, you know, creatures as well. Like, they're able to, you know, especially, like, you see, like, you can just, like, that's kind of what they seem to be suited for, is, like, adventuring in kind of all its forms. But what do you think about sort of incorporating a little bit about what Assassin's Creed does with, like, platforming and climbing things, and, like what are we talking in terms of the size of this world, do you reckon? Skyrim size, Breath of the Wild sized?
I'm probably leaning towards Breath of the Wild. I think, like, I'm just trying to think, like, how... You know, how far do they do it for a first game? And I think Breath of the Wild, because I mean, Skyrim is like, that's a pretty massive, I think that's a lot bigger, I think, compared to Breath of the Wild.
That's cool. Yeah, you know what, we have to keep going because we have you for a little bit less of a, you know, like, I mean, maybe 10 more minutes. So let's crack on with these hot takes. Yeah, okay, so here's what we need. Okay, here we go. So let's get out of the way. DLC, microtransactions, loot boxes, all that kind of thing. Now you have, like, we know about the negatives of microtransactions and stuff, and we're not going to even go into, like, anything loot boxy or anything like that. Personally, what I'd love to see is the option to, again, obviously to support developers as well, and as well as having that fun, the same thing that the people do with Overwatch, for example, is they just like to kind of kick the developers a few extra dollars just with, like, being able to download a cool skin. Like, that's as far as microtransactions should ever go. Screw the powering, screw the whole thing of, like, buying things that will make the game easier. It's just, like, aesthetics is fine.
Nah.
So I could definitely see skins of, like you can have classic gen skin and adventurer gen skin, and you can have, oh, Kira skin kind of thing. But what I wanted to get from you is, if we can't fit, like, what would you put as DLC, like, of the game? Would you have, like, something set in a completely different era, like the main game, for example, set before Dark Crystal, and then you can have a Power of the Dark Crystal DLC where you can explore, like, be as, like, free and, like, daydreamy as you want, man, because this could all become real one day. Go for it.
Yeah, I was just trying to think. Probably the big thing I think that would be interesting, I know they did this with again with Middle Earth, the Shadows of Mordor, how that DLC had like a prequel story, which was, like, pretty cool to sort of get that bit of the backstory with Talion and all that kind of stuff. And I was just thinking about sort of something along the lines, like, sort of a prequel story that sort of can delve almost, like, into the history of almost, like, recreating sort of some moments from the graphic novel, the creation myths, just getting to know more about the Earth Skeks and how they came to be and how the splitting sort of happened. Because I feel like, you know, for, you know, there'll be people who are sort of jumping onto the Dark Crystal for the first time and, you know, probably wanting to know those sort of backstories. And I feel like, you know, either telling that in the video game, I mean, there is that potential that they could actually do that in Age of Resistance as well. But I think it would be kind of cool, like, just to sort of get, yeah, just for people that are new, just to sort of get a deeper understanding of sort of the mythology. But yeah, like, I've never been a huge fan, like, yeah, with DLC, like, it's something I haven't really gotten really deep into. The only exception is really being just with story content. Yeah, like the Shadows of Mordor, Shadows of War, the Zelda DLC, I think I bought that, a couple of other little things, But I mean, like skins and stuff, like, yeah, like I think that'd be at least a cool little, you know, little feature. And I mean, if I did that with the Dark Crystal game, I'd probably just buy them all. So yeah.
And now this is just my pure indulgence here, and I'm doing this. By the way, I couldn't leave you off this podcast without telling you about Ghost of a Tale. Let's actually pause, and I need you to Google this. You need to go ghostofatale.com.
Ghost of a Tale.
Yeah, and that's T-A-L-E as well.
Yeah.
So you know about this game?
Don't think so.
That's okay. As long as it's showing up like it's this adventure kind of thing that you like, it's a mouse. You can see that.
Yeah.
Okay. So, just a quick little. I don't know if you and your fiance ever grew up with this sort of thing, but you know the Secret of Nim.
I have heard. Like, I know of the movie. I don't know why. It's one of those movies that I just actually haven't never seen.
I'm sending you that as well in December.
Yeah.
But yeah, dude. No. So the reason I send you to it first of all because like look at this game, it's incredible. And what it has this expansive kind of scope, but at the same time it does keep things like Zelda-ish, you know, closer in. You know, so it's this great walks this great line of you know, I think it's set in and around like a castle kind of thing. Please look into it, Phil, because as well as a touchstone for what we're talking about in terms to how like you, maybe it might be possible, like it might turn out that the devs are like, that's great, love that you have the Breath of the Wild ambitions, however this is our budget, this is what we can do, we want to incorporate some of the Breath of the Wild stuff like climbing and all that, but we just, this is our budget. And I can understand that. And so for that, for any devs listening about that and yourself, Phil, look at Ghost of a Tale. Now I spoke with Seath via the forums there. He's a fantastic guy. He's ex-DreamWorks. He worked on like the Prince of Egypt and stuff. And I'm going to be doing a dedicated show, interactive artistry episode for him as well. Hopefully get him on the show to talk about what he's doing with this. He developed it almost entirely himself. So Jose, please continue. Keep creating more assets. Keep like literally this sort of thing is where like this kind of game begins. So you're at the ground floor with this, Jose, who made that. You know, and I'll be getting in touch with you shortly after this. But needless to say, I spoke with him. This is, as I mentioned, I was getting a bit indulgent. I was like, I spoke with Seath on this forums, and I said, look, here is everything I want to see from a collector's edition, okay? And he sort of chuckled at me. He's like, that's great. That's adorable. You think that we have a budget for that? But okay, sure. Let me hear you out. Yeah. And I did, and I posted all the special collector's editions that I could see of this, and he sent me some postcards, which was really, really great, like just out of the activity, on the forums, sent like a signed letter and everything. And also I messaged Sony Santa Monica, same thing. I just sort of congratulated them and giving them support for, because we do God of War podcast. They were like insanely beautifully generously said they'll send something signed to us as well, which is ridiculous and awesome and super appreciated. Don't take it for granted. And so what I want to happen right now with this is I want to, at some point, like once I've put this together, I will link it to either Cheryl or something or someone related to Age of Resistance, have this sort of enter their consciousness and have them go to these things and be like, oh, whoa, look at Ghost of a Shell. Look at people excited about collector's editions of all things, you know, like look at these, like look at this activity. So and to sort of take inspiration from that and maybe start putting together these pitches for something like this, which, again, Jose, you need to be involved. But anyway, big tangent. But anyway, the question, Phil, is what would you want to see out of a collector's edition for this Dark Crystal? I need to get that information from you.
Yeah, I know, like I think it would have to be some like statue sort of, I don't know, like I'm just trying to think like what, maybe a statue of like the main characters of the games. It's something, like
Landstrider, like rearing up. And the thing is, I'm assuming obviously for the game you'd have to remodel it a little bit so that it could go faster, and I would love to see like a slightly tweaked remodeled thing, and then maybe like one of the heroes maybe from Age of Resistance. Would you want any of the protagonists from Age of Resistance to be maybe the lead player in the game, or would you want to do Arkham style, just separate them out so that each can be what they are? And Shadow of War, just have the separate, like there's no Viggo Mortensen, for example, in Shadow of War, like it's Talion.
I think I'd probably like them to be somewhat connected to Age of Resistance, just to have sort of that one sort of canon. But like I know, like with Batman, like with Arkham Asylum, like that works perfectly, like as its own thing. But I think with something, with the Dark Crystal, that I think I'd like, the game, I'd like for the game to have some kind of connective tissue with age resistance, or at least sort of the era at that time. Yeah.
Yeah, I really dig that, man. And what would be your closing thought? Because yeah, we have the rest of our weekends ahead of us. But what would be your closing comments and thoughts on a Dark Crystal open world RPG?
Well, I guess final thoughts is I guess now's the best time to do this video game. You know, now that we've got this Age of Resistance show happening, and I think very soon, when it comes out, next year, that I think a lot of fans, and not only the old fans who hopefully will enjoy it, but it's going to reach a much bigger audience than it's ever had with the Dark Crystal. So there'll be people seeing it for the first time, and they'll just be hopefully be blown away by what we were sort of back in the 80s, or if we discovered it in the VHS era in the 90s, or DVDs in the early 2000s. Just what amazing the world is, and there's just a lot of potential. With storytelling, what different eras you could tell it in, and I just want to make this exist.
Yeah, my man, I'm gonna give you one of these. Legend, yeah. Dude. I am like, Link, thank you so much. That was a perfect way of tailing it off, dude. I am really glad we met up through the messages and everything, through that sort of shared mind space of Dark Crystal. And this is essentially what we've just, like, I'll be, like, closing up the recording, editing it, putting it out there. You and me, we've just sort of put this out there into just to kind of join that collective swirl of, people, like, ruminating on this, having plans for this, maybe thinking about this. Maybe someone like Jose, who developed this, he hears this, is like, oh, wow, that's connected to what I want to do. This is all connected. Yeah. Let's put this out there. And so what I feel as though we've done, even though I'm not like smoke blowing or anything, like I feel as though like that's something we've kind of like put together here, and I feel like it will benefit both Dark Crystal and the interactive medium.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, very exciting.
For sure. I feel like I met a brother from another mother, man. You're a legend. So great to meet you, man.
Yeah, no, it's great to meet you too. And just thank you so much for letting me be part of the of Make This Exist podcast. It's
my man, great. Exactly, and interactive artistry, and same right back to you for letting me be a part of the upcoming Gathering Songs. Can't wait for that on the 23rd or 24th, what was it again?
So we're recording on the 24th.
24th, yeah. That's the one, yeah, and I'll set the alarms and everything. But dude, I'll wrap up the show. I'll just be like, so listeners, look, we if to close out the show, we at Interactive Artistry are always looking to improve and streamline the show so we can make it the best sort of be-all end-all destination for showcasing the most worthwhile games and creators that are contributing to the overall growth of this medium. With that in mind, if you have suggestions for either of us and if you wanted to get in touch with Phil, I'll throw it to you. What are the ways in which our listeners can get in touch with you, buddy?
Yeah, so you can get in touch with me through the Dark Crystal podcast, Trial by Stone. So we're pretty much all over social media. So our Facebook, we're on facebook.com/Dark Crystal Podcast. We're on Twitter, which we're at Dark Crystal Pod, because we couldn't get enough characters to podcast. So Dark Crystal Pod. We're also on Instagram at instagram.com/Dark Crystal Podcast. You can find the show on iTunes or Podbean or Stitcher. And we also have a Patreon campaign as well. If you're interested in supporting the show, at patreon.com/Dark Crystal Podcast.
Speaking of which, just sort of weaving it all together, interactiveartistry@gmail.com. If you wanted to get in touch with me and sort of suggest things and sort of partake in this kind of big kind of dialogue we sort of have across all these sort of underappreciated and very much in need of just like people coming together and boosting them and bringing them to the sort of greatest fulfillment of what they can be. And then, yes, speaking of which, ourselves as well, Interactive Artistry, patreon.com/interactiveartistry if you wanted to, help us grow and just sort of everyone kind of coming together like Podling Village style and just like having a good time on the web with Dark Crystal and games. Phil, once again, an honor, a privilege, and I'm very, very, very happy that you jumped on the show today.
Yeah, no worries. Yeah. Great. Great to be on the show. Yeah.
Yeah. Have a great rest of the day, man.
Yeah, you too.
The idea of Kratos being able to change because of his child. That idea of how much of ourselves our real selves do we show our children, and how much of what we do changes when we know we have a mirror reflecting our flaws back at us. But I think for people to really see truly that we were trying to do something different, we just had to zig when they expected us to zag. Teaching is kind of an important aspect of the game, passing on of knowledge from father to son. It's interesting because this character that we've been so familiar with, seeing him kind of start to make different decisions, seeing him struggle, he has this god side and this human side, two things that were never meant to coexist together. The son is teaching him how to be human. It's bringing out that sort of closeted humanity that he stamped down.
When we set out to build this game, we wanted to show gamers what the next generation of gaming was going to be like. It meant that we needed to build a new experience. The camera lenses we use are similar to the lens that we use if you were shooting a movie. Lens curvature on the screen because of the camera lens. There's chromatic aberration because there's separation of color that happens naturally through a lens. It's those imperfections that make you feel like something is alive.
One thing that was extremely unique experience for me as someone who's done this with films, television, and books mostly, in fact, for some reason, the storyline as well as the philosophical underpinnings, when you're playing the game and controlling the character, or you know that the person next to you is controlling it, it sticks in your mind even deeper than a great work of literature or a cinematic masterpiece.
Well, that's the benefit of making this game, is that we knew we could leverage interactivity. We knew we could leverage mechanics, something completely unique to video games. No other kind of form medium can get you to feel that kind of connection to another character.
We wanted to create some very, very beautifully rendered, very engaging emotionally, a choice-based game to have the tonality and the emotionality of the films.
At every stage in the design process, hone in on the core value, the core thing, the one piece of meaning that we really need to communicate through this work of art. Video games have the capacity to connect people and help them share their feelings, their thoughts, that shows their true creative spirit.
I think everything is an art. Anything human does has a potential to express, and they are all art.
Have a design process that does actually start with an emotion. And then we try and take all of the elements, a story, but also the visual language of the game and the audio and the interaction itself to feed that emotional journey.
Okay, you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here. Yeah,
see,
yeah.
See, now that's how I know you're a podcaster, is because you don't just hang up. You finish the show,
and then
you have the post show. But dude, that was so fun. We have to do this again in some way, right?
Yeah.
So good. I mean, we might even have like a special Dark Crystal report. Say if we do hear any sort of news of anything rumbling up. Like if we see, we'll have to call up again, do another one of these. If we hear any noise whatsoever, and just be like, "Holy crap, it actually happened!"
Yeah,
so that could be cool. But I'm gonna have a lot of fun editing around all of our ums and ahs, which I'm just as guilty of as you.
I know I'm pretty.
I'm terrible. I'm
myself, yeah.
Yeah. Although Jeff Goldblum has both of us on that one. He's pretty horrible, and he'll admit that. He's like, "Oh, I'm always hemming and hawing, as they say." All right, buddy. Have a fantastic rest of the weekend, man. I'll catch you later.
Yeah. No worries. Sorry.
See you, man. Bye.
Catch you. Bye.
Am I speaking with Phil?
Yes, you are. And I'm presuming I'm speaking to Albert.
That is me. Good to speak with you, my man.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, no worries.
After all the communication, you know, via the digital tappy-tappies, as I call them.
Yes, of course, yeah.
Has it been a good Saturday so far for yourself?
Just had breakfast and just sort of tying things up around the place. And...
Yeah, that's right. Am I right? I'll give you one maybe possible commiseration. Isn't it true that when you put something like as a plan on the weekend, and then you just because of the rest of the week, you know that there's like either you're in possibly a different space to when you initially made the plan, or sometimes there are like things that come up and you're like, "Oh crap, I got that to do as well." So I can, it's a bit like that sometimes.
Yeah, it can be. I guess for me, like, most of my weekends are already pretty planned out, where it's, like, just sitting with family or, I don't know, like, we just somehow get things, you know, have the weekend sort of sorted pretty much by Wednesday in a weird way. So,
But that's all right. I agree with you, man, and especially, and I'm sure you can relate with the show and everything, it's, there's the increasing need to, obviously, like, plan, it can be a bit interesting, actually, with scheduling, eh?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's the big thing, like, especially with my podcast, because I try and, you know, book interviews with people, and most of them are from the US, so it can be a bit tricky to schedule, try and, you know, have the right time to get everyone together, whether it's, like, those big discussion shows or, there was a couple of times where, like not for the show, but it was something else that I think I stayed up, I think, like, 1 a.m.
Whoa.
To chat to someone over Skype. So, yeah.
That's crazy, man. And yeah, like...
But, like, you do early chats, don't you? Like,
yeah, I...
Because was there something I... It's 3 a.m.
Like, yeah, I fully take advantage of this weird, like, it's this weird biological freak of nature thing where I'm able to just, like, like, just shut off my body or shut it back on at whim. It's probably doing some kind of damage, I'm sure. But, like, whenever I need to be awake for someone's, like, convenience on the other end, it's weirdly, like, must be, like, my body, like, registers it as this, like, utmost, like, priority on, like, a physical level. And I just immediately... Yeah, yeah. Just wake up whenever as needed. However, lately, and I think I might try and follow this, like, lately my body's been like, okay, here's your first strike of just, like, this probably isn't very good for you, and my body's been sort of waking up at, like, 5 a.m. instead of, like, 2 a.m. And so what I'm gonna do is, like, just gently start exploring whether or not, because again, it's because of the time zone difference, someone's being inconvenienced, you know.
Yeah.
So if it has to be someone, I'd usually rather it be me, but maybe we should take turns with my co-hosts. Have you checked out any of Interactive Artistry's other shows?
I haven't, like, listened to an episode, fully, but I have, like, okay, you know, listened to, you know, a couple of them. And they seem like, pretty cool. Like, I kind of like them. So I know I just need to find time to sort of listen. Because I know, like, I think some of the episodes, like, they go for quite a while. Like, it was just something like 2 or 3 hour episodes.
That's our thing. It's kind of our thing. Yeah.
But
that's the thing is, what I'll say, and I didn't mean to cut you off, by the way. What I'll say is that because of the longer format, and that's the thing, is like, for a while I was like, oh, who knows whether or not that's listener friendly, and I'm sure maybe you encountered this when setting up Dark Crystal Podcast, of like, oh, well, is it like, am I the person to be doing this, and will this really work out for people with this format? I mean, again, Dark Crystal isn't exactly, I mean, it's changed so much since, especially with, like, the official website and, you know, the Cheryl Henson interview and all these symptoms that Dark Crystal is really on the ascendant. But I'm sure it may have possibly crossed your mind, like, oh, well, you know, I wonder if that I'll be able to carry this, and I went wonder whether this will find an audience, etc., etc. And we're here, you know, since August 2014 when you began, we're here for, like, how many episodes do you have, man, under your belt?
All right, so right now, like, with the podcast, so I have over 40 episodes. So actually, I think I'm up to episode 48.
Nice.
So 48 just came out.
I've been saying around that you've done 150. For some reason, you give the impression that you've done 150.
It's probably because, I mean, I know my shows, when I first started, I only did it as a once a month thing. Yeah. And that was just more because, well, one, you know, there wasn't too much happening in Dark Crystal, like, in the early years. It was really just waiting for things to come out, like with the young adult novel. And then there was this graphic book, The Creation Myths, Volume 3, that we were waiting for that to come out. That got delayed for, I don't know why.
All
right. It was just that. And, I mean, that was a thing, like, with last year, that I was actually thinking of what to do with the podcast.
Yeah.
I mean, this is, you know, before early last year, like before Age of Resistance, and I was thinking whether to just, you know, to stop it or to, you know, pass it on to someone who might want to continue doing it.
Or hiatus or something, yeah.
Yeah, or a bit of a hiatus, yeah, just because there wasn't much, I mean, like, we had, there was still a couple of things to look forward to, like, before Age of Resistance, like, you still had these young adult novels that another two books to go, and then you also have the Power of the Dark Crystal comics, which has sparked a lot of controversy.
Yes.
With the recent issue, so, yeah.
I'm looking forward to diving into all that, man, but what I wanted to say is, as a kind of as a summary of what I feel is a really, really intuitive and intelligent approach that you've had towards Dark Crystal and this content and your show, is that you scaled it. You scaled it according to, you gauged, you didn't just barrel through, which can sometimes, you know, especially when there's a bit of a drought of information, you want to not, you don't want to cross that line into contrivance or into diving too deep or just like making it like, yeah, just like not of it not being sincere or of it not feeling necessary in a way, and you don't want to stretch it out or like spread it, as Bilbo would say, I suppose, spread it over too much bread, you know, kind of thing, you know, like that was kind of the vibe that I've never encountered that, not in a single one of your episodes, man. It just means that you're in touch with the material, you're in touch with your audience, and yeah, man. I'll just say it here. Obviously, I've referenced it, so our listeners can hear. I've referenced it in our chats, you know, on like the Tappy, the chats and stuff. That like, yeah. You know, your work was definitely a part of the sort of pool of signs from the universe and like inspirations and touchstones for creating interactive artistry. So I love that it's cool. Yeah, I'm super like honored and pleased and privileged. Yeah, to have you on the show, buddy.
Oh, wow, no worries, I'm very happy to hear about how this, got the interactive artistry happening, so that's fantastic, yeah.
Sure. Speaking of which, let's crack on with, I'll do the 3-2-1, and then we'll jump into the intro, and we'll just get started, man. I mean, we have a very loose structure on the show, yeah. So on a 3,
yeah, cool.
Mm-hmm, and 3, and 2, and 1. That's all good, dude. I certainly will. although I do like your sounds. They're great. I'm going to put them in the bloopers. It's like disco sound effects.
See, I'm trying to think which Lisa.
Hey, Phil, right. Phil.
Yeah.
Phil. Shout out to editing. Shout out to editing. Hey, how fucking great is it?
Yeah.
Makes us sound so smooth and like we know what the fuck we're doing. Also, profanity-wise, I'm happy to bleep if that's something you don't want to be on a show associated with swear words. Please do let me know. We didn't talk about that, but how do you feel about that, Phil?
Probably bleep me out. Yeah.
We'll do, buddy. Absolutely. Let's make this one a clean episode.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
And
so also, I apologize if I have been swearing and that hasn't been really, like, I do apologize. No. Like, is that cool? Yeah.
Yeah.
Too easy.
That is. I'm really trying to think of the name.
That's okay.
One of those things where I'm just like, I gotta go on IMDb so you can edit it out.
We're gonna sound so silky smooth. This is gonna transition straight immediately into you answering it. I love editing. I fucking love it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Go for it. But that's okay. Oh, and also, I figured I'd let you know. Going to be probably, I'll get in touch with him, but I'm pretty sure Jose would be happy with me just like including his work in our descriptions and then possibly even using a little, like, just go like 4K, whatever kind of highest resolution, using some of just one screenshot of that demo of the Valley of the Mystics as a thumbnail, because that's perfect.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I just. Let's make it exist.
Make it exist, my man. Did you just do that? That's fantastic.
Yeah,
what a great way.
Wait. I'll do it again.
And make this exist.
And,
yeah, go.
Oh yeah, make this exist. Yeah. And yeah, I just want to make this exist.
Yeah, my man. I'm gonna give you one of these. Legend. Yeah.
Thank you.